Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, friends, fans, and dabbers, to the Paragon Masters.
I can't. That's all I can do. You guys have a good night.
It doesn't get better than that. It doesn't get better than that.
Literally,
anymore. I can't believe we just did that. What just happened?
Thank you for tuning into the now final match.
I'm embarrassed for us.
Yes, sure. My chair's about to break. I'm not in a good spot.
Oh, man. We just get... Mad Chrissy did not like the dab.
Not at all. I didn't even like the dab.
It looks like no one liked the dab.
I feel like we made mistakes. I apologize, everybody. I apologize to all of you. This is what happens when we go on break.
Yeah.
Shane just starts doing shit in his camera, and then Christian's like, let's do it, and we dabbed, and I apologize. I apologize.
You can say that we dabbed in it.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. Well, hey, here at the Paragon Masters, we're really trying stuff out here. We want to see what works, what doesn't. So just give us grace as we test it out. Like, if we would have done that and chat would have gone crazy and we would have gotten, like, $600 and, like, nice dab from a random person,
yep. we
would have, like, this is great. We'll just keep doing this. But it didn't happen, so we're done. We're just going to move on, and we're done. So up next, Shane, another notch, friends, fans of the audience, we have Mayhem versus Straight Out of Agora. So again, we've only seen Straight Out of Agora play once. So they played our first broadcast on Tuesday, and then following that, we had Mayhem, which playing last Thursday. This is what I kind of want to talk about. Again, we talked about a little bit in the pre-show, but again, just the strength of Mayhem going toe-to-toe against Triangle Formation. Probably the first time that we've seen the Paragon Masters, a team giving them a solid run for their money. But in the pre-show, Notch, you said, you know, Straight Out of Agora, if we see them play the way you guys have seen them play in Agora's Rising, that you believe that they are going to take this. Maybe elaborate for just really quickly before we get in the match about that.
Yeah, so Straight Out of Agora has been a team that we've seen a lot of in Agora's Rising, and they've always been a strong team. They've always had really strong showings. The past couple events, though, they've fallen off, and I don't know if that's them adjusting to 0.27 and trying to adjust. It even started happening before that, but I feel with 0.27 in the past couple events, the past couple times we've seen them, they've struggled a bit. If it's SOA we've seen from Agora's Rising 2 or 3, they had a very strong showing. These guys can come out and they can really play as a team really well, and they could easily take this match.
Okay, Shane, your thoughts.
SOA did have a roster change. Omain is no longer, he's either being subbed out or he's no longer on the roster. I'm not sure which one. Roster changes can go either way. Sometimes that's the fix they were looking for, and sometimes it can make a problem worse.
Sure.
But we'll see. I think it's all going to come down to their ability to stay consistent, because that's always been their biggest problem. SOA's biggest problem, and I've heard this from people who have faced against them, that they're inconsistent. When they're playing well, they're one of the best in the world. But it's very, very hit and miss with them.
They get flustered. They get flustered easily, I think.
Well, I mean, real quickly, again, just before we move on from the last match between Triangle Formation and Evolve, just speaking about roster changes, one thing I just want to commend Evolve for is having gone through such a crazy roster change from the last time we saw them to just this match, they performed beautifully well. Just getting a couple of the kills on Triangle Formation, some fantastic team fights, and to be able to do that with a new group of people that you're playing with that you haven't coordinated with for a while is really commendable. So I can't wait to see them as this continues. Hopefully finding that team camaraderie between them and obviously.
Dual Spirals made a great point in chat. He's like, if I didn't have to build my team 3 days ago,
Well said, Dual Spirals. Well said, indeed. I totally agree with that. I think that's definitely a very valid point. But right now, ladies and gentlemen, our what was going to be first, now second and final match of the night is Team Mayhem versus Straight Out of Agora. Shane, Notch, you guys at 5 seconds?
Of course. I'm at the cinco.
All right, guys, let's get right into it. In 3, 2, 1. Let's do this, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome, like I said, to our what was first, now second, and final matchup of the night between Straight Out of Agora versus Team Mayhem. Shane, walk us through who we got on the blue side.
On the blue side, Straight Out of Agora, Leo Grande, for those of you that like Starbucks. SOA Nazgul, no longer the solo Nazgul.
What?
Reflect on the Giggity Grux, Pixel on the Giggity Grim, and Peace Turtle on Steel.
All right, now over on Orange. Who we got, Natch?
For Team Mayhem, we've got Live Lunatic on Iggy and Scorch. Griever on the greatest hero in the game, Rampage. Blaze Master B on Murdoch. Seismic is on Steel, and Selig is on Sparrow.
Now, let me real quickly pull up the bans for this. I know Decker was banned out.
Of course.
I want to say Twin Blast.
Of course. Let's see. Let's see.
Probably Twin Blast.
Yep. Decker and Twin Blast. You were right.
Yeah.
Decker and Greystone. I knew it.
Wait a second.
Greystone and Muriel.
That's the other thing. We haven't seen Greystone. And you guys
talk about it. Do you know who is on the field that is directly related to Greystone? And this is one of the things I can say.
Sparrow
is Greystone's uncle.
Really?
Yes.
Sparrow's is.
I'm not even kidding. That was from KL. He said it live on the dev
Sparrow
stream.
Is Greystone's uncle.
It's like a Kardashian thing.
Yeah, she was.
And
at one point,
man,
Greystone was a woman.
Yeah. 50 years as a man, Olympic athlete. She couldn't take it anymore, and now. He's Katniss Everdeen. It's really interesting.
Up on the political and social justices of our day.
Yeah, man.
They really are. Really.
That's what just makes them one of the best devs in the world right now, is their ability to take current events and make it applicable inside the futuristic sci-fi world of the wonderful game that we know as Paragon. Now, the thing about Sparrow is if you can protect her and give her that farm,
she's good.
She can do beautiful things in the mid-game. But out of all the Rangers, she is the worst at playing from behind. There's a Grux they have to worry about. Obviously, Selig on Mayhem. There's a Grux on the other side of Reflect. And if I'm playing Reflect, my main goal in the first 15 minutes of this match, and even then from there on, is smash and grabbing that Sparrow and making her life as difficult
while you're
as
saying that, though, Peace Turtle is actually been caught out. Good rotation out of Griebury. He was able to hit him with stone, but Leo Grande saw that and was able to actually rotate up out of the jungle and keep that kill from happening. So good rotation out of Leo Grande. Good counter rotation there. Sorry, Shane. You can go back to what you were saying.
Yeah, sorry.
It's fine.
Sparrow's uncle?
It's fine. Yeah, something about saying uncle.
No, Reflect as or Selig, I'm sorry, on Sparrow.
Yeah.
That hero. If you allow her to farm, if you allow her to get those last hits, if you allow her, and she has an ability now. If she lands 10 attacks, her basic attack hits harder. She can actually be quite a dangerous hero. You want to watch the flank on her. Her ultimate ability, she can hit multiple people with her ultimate. You really want to watch the flank on this hero. She is a very strong hero, but she needs the farm.
Yeah.
She needs those last hits, and she is going to need protection from Seismic, and that's why you're seeing Steel and Sparrow in the lane.
So now,
I think that's a beautiful decision for them to do that. Just, and the thing about Sparrow, a lot of people don't realize, well, she's very susceptible in the early stages because the aforementioned things about her just lack of mobility and lack of escape. But her auto attacks early on actually do the most out of all the Rangers. So she's actually quite deceiving when it comes to how much damage she dishes out in the early stages of the match. When it comes to her scaling, she still scales about the same in the late game, but early on, if you let her get that buildup of her E, of that extra damage, she actually will all of a sudden just be chunking you away, whether you're a Steel or whether you're a Twin Blast.
So one thing I want to talk about as well is if you are Shred of Gora, right, you see and you know obviously how Sparrow works and her strengths, her weaknesses, and you know if she doesn't get the farm, she's not going to be as much of a threat in the game. Do you spend that extra time trying to gank a Sparrow Steel lane? Or do you just go, this might not be worth it. Well, I guess we'll just get her, let her kind of farm up to a certain point and then start dealing with her. Or are you going to try to put as much pressure over there constantly as possible?
I feel putting too much pressure on that lane will actually hinder your team. They have Peace Turtle and Pixel over here. They've got, they have a Steel and a Grim who is super strong ranged. It's a good way to counter that. We'll see a lot of bumping of the fists. We'll see a lot of counter initiation between the two fighting each other. While I'm saying that, we got to be careful. Live Lunatic is rotating behind, Reflect. He does have his ultimate. Flame Belch
actually saved him. The boulder. Blaze is going in there. Is he going to try to light him up? Blaze Master not going to light him up.
Wow. Yeah, that's
going to be able to light him up.
Flame Belch with Reflect able to basically charge away instead of being pushed back.
Was great,
Lunatic was trying to do. It actually saved him there. It was a big boulder out of Griever, but he was just too far behind that tower already.
It's a boulder.
They're not gonna get that kill. It's a boulder.
Sorry, Commander. I will work on not getting quieter as we now have... Uh-oh, Selig. Got to be careful.
He does, but the rotation coming up from Pixel should be enough. And Selig, farewell. First blood. Peace Turtle with the BM shield. talk to the hand, if you will. They clean them up, and that's pretty much exactly what we've been talking about. Don't do that if you're Sparrow.
And if you,
I mean, that's what, you can't even leave, like, go down to the Shadow Pool. You have to play so smart if you're by yourself. And if you don't, then those sort of opportunities are going to present themselves, and teams of this caliber are going to jump on them every single time. So, I mean, let's take a look at the numbers first time 6 minutes into the game. I mean, is there any sort of significant difference? Not really. Level 9 to level 6. But the thing I want to see in the future is that death on Sparrow going to be significant 5 to 10 minutes from now? Is there going to be a discrepancy from there?
Sure.
Because Selig is at 6 card points compared to Pixel and everyone else on the side of the field. So just putting Sparrow behind even just that little bit can really kind of pay off in the long run. Another thing I just realized here, only one Ranger on the side of Straight Out of Agora. So their late game, they got to be careful about this game going late, else they can find themselves in very, very awkward position and just dying to the strength of the draft that Mayhem has nailed it.
Let's talk about Griever right now, who just took Leo Grande's blue from him and is now on his way out very deep in the enemy jungle. I don't know if Leo Grande just saw him, and if he did, I'm wondering why Reflect was not rotating down to try to stop him. I guess Rampage is so hard to kill.
That is my favorite thing to do in the jungle. Yeah. Run up and last hit a minion and last hit and steal those that precious card power away. Seismic here is in a really bad spot.
Griever, all the meanwhile, dive in a tower. For Reflect of all people, he's got to be careful.
Griever, Seismic is going to fall in the jungle.
Yeah, so there's two fights going down at the same time, one during a tower and one on the other side of the field. That was just that fight we just saw, Notch, that you were play-by-playing while I was play-by-playing the other one. That was just a timed push on the red buff. That was well coordinated. They steal the red buff, they get a kill on steel. That's a very triangle formation esque sort of thing to see coming out of SOA.
And Nazgul's gonna have to be careful here. He is extended pretty far forward. Griever is gonna rotate behind him. I do think Nazgul, with the way auto sprint works, the 5 seconds did not come. He dropped a turret, but he is gonna get caught out. How is he tanky? He's not tanky yet.
No.
Are we going to see rotation out of Pixel and Leo Grande? I mean, they are pushing a tower. Yeah. Nazgul is backing off, and I think Griever is just going to let it be. Griever knows there's three members of the team there. He's just going to have to back off.
Yep.
So it is a good defense of that Tier 1 tower, and they defended both of their Tier 1 towers, even though Nazgul got the mid
Seismic Stats level 5. Peace Turtle got the shield slam. Again, they're isolating that Sparrow and taking her out. Any more than Sparrow inside of that ultimate is icing on the cake. And that they went for the Sparrow. They got it. They almost lit up Blazemaster into a haze, if you will. Seismic, he'll be okay.
Oh, I will.
We don't see the card yet. We don't see the card yet, but we've got two Iggy's. On both teams, and Iggy and Scorch.
I see where you're going with this.
Yeah, Iggy and Scorch are both, and if they have it, are both going to pick up a tainted magic.
Yes.
And that's going to be to shut down Rampage's health regen. When tainted magic goes off, the poison is applied. Well, actually, instead of getting 100% of the health regen, it basically shuts down 75%. He gets 25% regen.
Insane.
From tainted magic.
It so it's also basically does that a counter life pick. Steal. As well.
Yeah, also does it for lifesteal as well. It's basically a counterpick. The Iggy is basically a counterpick to that Rampage, who is able to so effectively dive towers because towers are very weak right now, and Rampage's regen is just absolutely absurd. So that Tainted Magic is going to really help them make sure they're securing those kills onto a very, very strong front line for both teams because they both have Steel and Rampage.
Well, I think, just like you said, the whole kit of Rampage is that regen makes him so ridiculous to kill, and he's able to dive towers. Speaking of getting dove, Reflect might be in some trouble here.
Reflect was very overextended trying to get that kill on Seismic. Big ult coming out of Seismic. Reflect should fall. Selic is dealing a ton of big ultimate coming out of Reflect here. Rotation out of Leo Grande onto Selic.
Leo Grande is going to fall. They get the counter kill, and I would actually say at this stage of the game, taking out that Sparrow. As well as Blazemaster got taken out on the other side of the field as well. I think that was over by the black buff. Speaking of which, left lane, they got to be careful. But Pixel took out Blazemaster. Selig went down as well. I was going to say that favored SOA with just that one kill. But without a doubt, now that they took out both of the Rangers,
right.
They have a great opportunity here. Black buff isn't up. It actually was taken by Nazgul a couple minutes ago.
Yeah.
But still, they can push a tower. They can try to get something going.
Peastorto just used the shockwave.
And it like double knocked.
Double knocked Rampage.
Did you guys see that?
Yeah, yeah.
As Peastorto was jumping, he got shockwave and launched up into the air even higher. But was that, I mean, that shockwave, it's kind of a waste of that shockwave right there.
I agree.
It is only 120 second cooldown, so it's not like it's not going to come back up. But I mean, he used it, and there is no value for it at this moment in time. They may be able to get the tower, but I doubt it with Blazemaster B being back alive.
I mean, it's kind of a good thing that Epic has, you know, thought these things out. But I feel like, man, if you were in your early access game, maybe a shockwave on top of a Rampage jumping at the same time, the game couldn't calculate for it, and just Rampage goes flying into the atmosphere. That's what I was hoping to see.
I have flown into the atmosphere. There is another kill on Seismic here. Very overextended. There's a lot of counter jungling going on for both of these teams.
Yeah.
And Leo Grande was in the jungle there. They were able to rotate up and get that kill on Steel.
And all meanwhile, Blazemaster, man. Yeah, they're just 420 no-scoping the guys on the Blazemaster every single time they have opportunity to do so. They just light them up.
So there's a lot of action going on, guys. I don't see Christian's feed.
No.
I'm not sure what you're seeing here, but there's a lot of just random fights taking place.
I cannot even find them. It's like, oh, cool. Oh, he just died. Oh, this guy. Oh, he just died. Like, where in the world is this going down? I'm watching now very, very closely. Anytime an orange on top of a blue, I'm just going to go to it. Like right now with Griever.
Reflect is actually going to... He's taking this tower, this tier 1 tower over here in the right lane. He's got a minion wave with him. He should be able to get it. I see no rotation. Blazemaster B is coming.
He's pretty much going
to He's actually not. Until the second minion wave...
Over on the other side of the field, though. Live Lunatic gets taken out. One for one thus far. And Rampage goes down as well. That was... I feel like that was just mayhem... pushing the issue. They had Rampage dive in the tower. Griever was tanking the tower, but they have to be so very careful of that. And they were pushing the tower. I think they were just trying to trade, but they forced it. Reflect was able to get that tower, and they gave up kills on the other side of the field. Mayhem is, I mean, it's 9-2 kills at a baker's dozen minute into the games. It's a very, very awkward position to be in, but it's sort of at the same time, what could they have done differently there? They were already sort of dedicated to that push in that lane. They knew that if they were able to rotate to the right lane, they probably would have been a little bit too late. That tower had gone down. So, like, let's try to trade a tower, but they forced the issue a little bit too much. Either way, they lose a tower or maybe get some kills out of it. It just this game has not been going the way of Mayhem in almost every single metric.
Well, here's the thing, too. Looking at the card points, Strand of Gore, the lowest card point member on the team, Peastorto and Leo Grande have 18, and that is the highest card point total. Onto Mayhem with Live Lunatic there on Iggy and Scorch. That's you can start seeing that gap between both of these teams. And what does Mayhem right now need to do to make sure that does not increase?
Stop diving towers when there's no reason to.
I'll be completely honest.
That was a very odd play that they just did. It was careless. They did get a kill out of it. But instead of losing those, or instead of dying needlessly, make sure you're dying for something. There wasn't a lot of damage going out onto that tower. So they have to stop making plays like that. They have to rotate a little bit quicker because they're not responding, to engagements. I mean, we just watched, SOA basically take a tier one tower for free. The rotation was very slow. They need to rotate more effectively and they need to start farming a little bit better. They're being very aggressive, and every time they get aggressive, they're dying for it. So they need to stop that. They need to start pushing lanes a little bit more, and they just need to farm it out here.
They're going in here. So this is something that a lot of people don't realize, is the black buff increases damage to towers, obviously, but also to harvesters as well.
Yeah, we don't see that a lot.
So that's exactly what's happening here. Is Nazgul, they're getting as much value out of this black orb as they possibly can. They got the tower mid lane, which they probably would have gotten with or without the black buff, but they immediately rotated and said, let's try to pick off some harvesters. Let's continue to asphyxiate our opponent. That's exactly what they're doing, not only with map control, but taking away sort of that fallback mechanisms that teams sometimes can use when they're at a card experience deficit, is being more efficient with the harvesters. And that's just outright smart play from Strand of Gore.
Take a look at the creep score difference right now.
Yeah, it's
220 to 167. I mean, it's right now they have to step up the farm. They were trying to be aggressive, and it hasn't paid off at all. So they need to just step up the farm. The issue is now, though, is you've got tier one towers down. It leaves SOA to basically free farm your jungle and deny you that incredible card power and experience that comes out of the jungle. And you have to still worry about lanes being pushed in and overextending. So this is a very steep hill that these guys are going to have to climb out of. And Team Mayhem right now, if they continue to be overly aggressive, it's just going to cost them the game.
I think it's a great point you bring up, Naj, because we, again, talked last week, and with this new patch, the importance of the jungle and how powerful it is right now. When you are able to, right now Steel going in, though, over on the left side.
He's just trying to defend the tower. He's got to be careful, though, not to get isolated. Griever's coming in with the flank onto Pixel. He better use that ult. He might get focused down. There's the big devastating blast onto Pixel from across the map. That global strength from Murdoch being effective. They're really diving hard here. They got to be careful because they're outnumbered. It's two. Okay, it's a 3v4, but still the flame belch, the shockwave into the shield slam. Good lord. Line him up, if you will. Seismic actually gets knocked up to the tier 2 level. So he's going to be able to get away. An unfortunate circumstance for SOA. But they're still going to get that smasher grab onto the live lunatic. They're looking for a Griever. Can they get Griever? They do get him right there. Beautiful play from Reflex.
Leo Grande's
Brooks,
not down.
He goes in there with the ultimate, smacking around the Sparrow. Sparrow is calling for Uncle, but it's not going to happen. She gets taken out. And now that's the 3 kills and another tier 1 tower. SOA are looking wonderful, and they aren't done yet. Now Blazemaster is a little bit in a very unfortunate situation. He's going to get taken out. And man, SOA just popped a can open. And wow, laid it all on the line right there.
This is gonna be an easy tier 2 tower here. I mean, just that engagement there. They got, again, very aggressive Mayhem. You had the huge ultimate onto 3 out of Seismic, but there was no follow up there. Right, the rotation came out of SOA. They were able to easily clean that up. They're gonna lose a tier 2 tower. At this point, I mean, you could get greedy and continue to push for the inhibitor, but we're mostly going to see these guys back off. They've got card power to spend. I mean, there are 30 card points with only 21 of those used. We're going to see these guys back off, and we're most likely going to see a push for the Prime Orb right now.
Yeah, I agree. Black buff is going to be up here in about 20 seconds. They could do black buff. They could do Orb Prime. They could just sit back and farm. The red and blue buffs are about to spawn on both sides of the fields. They could look for an aggressive timing, which is what they've done before. Maybe continue to lay on that aggression, invade the jungle, get the red, get the blue, pick up a kill. There's a lot of things. This is SOA's map right now, man. And the mechanism that Mayhem... What mechanism does Mayhem have to get themselves back in this map, into this game, Notch?
Honestly, at this point, it's I want to say continue to farm, but you're at such a deficit when it comes to card power. You've got tier 2 towers down. The lead is it comes down to this farm. They can't farm in the jungle, because if they do, they get overextended, and we're seeing that happen right now, where Peace Turtle is rotating. He was actually coming over to take this camp. Blazemaster B was able to back off, but you allow SOA can be hyper aggressive now. They've got a very good card powered lead. They know that the jungle is basically free reign for them, and the way Mayhem comes back is going into that jungle and getting that valuable card experience, and they're just not going to be able to do it. I mean, look at where all of Mayhem and SOA are. They're all in the jungle, and Mayhem is sitting here, or SOA is waiting, and they picked up Blazemaster B, and Blazemaster B is going to fall again. Leo Grande misses his rock, but Peace Turtle's right there, and that's going to be a dead Murdoch.
Leo Grande threw the rock a little bit high over Blazemaster, but nonetheless, they still pick up the kill anyways, and this should be... with no Murdoch to worry about, they should be able to take this Orb Prime, the first Orb Prime of the game, completely uncontested. And with the map control that they've awarded themselves through the great play, the course of this game, they should be able to turn it in with just a slow siege. They have the Grux, they have the Rampage, they have the Steel. It's funny because a lot of people, kind of the rhetoric with this patch right now is, Ranger, it's just, triple Ranger, triple Ranger, triple Ranger, Ranger. But we've seen frequently we see teams go with, like, one Ranger compositions or a lot of melee-centric front-loaded damage compositions. So that's a beautiful thing. I think Rangers are very prevalent in this meta, but obviously SOA, and we've seen Triangle Formation make statements before with, we're going to go triple melee with a Grux plus a Steel, just a lot of initiation, get in your face, get aggression. And I love that we're seeing success with these sort of strategies other than just the typical Ranger meta, which this game has been, has been known for dating all the way back to March.
Yeah, we're seeing very effective farming of for the jungle of SOA. Not only are they taking theirs, but they were also aggressively farming enemy jungle and giving themselves that advantage, allowing them to rotate up and behind Mayhem and pick up some of those kills. Leo Grande here, he is overextended, but he's Rampage with a very big lead. He's just going to run by. He's going to dodge.
He's done.
Everything Seismic is punching, and he's just going to run by and he's going to turn to SA. No need to also
So with that happening, they needed to make their stand. Yeah, they needed to make their stand. They're going to go for it now, but they're going to worry about the prime card. Leo Grande's going in there, and he's going to try to get a kill. The rock onto Selig. They've been focusing down this Sparrow so effectively. A Sparrow into a composition with Grux, Rampage, and Steel. I think this is what you were kind of expecting to see, and it's certainly been the big Achilles heel thus far. Griever's going to body block for his buddy Seismic, but nonetheless, it's still going to take an exorbitant amount of damage onto what frontliners they have available. But prime card activated. Two down on the field for Mayhem. This inhibitor's dead, and it's just it might even be the game. If you're Mayhem right here, oh no, Blaze, farewell, my friend. He was up on that high ground right there, but unfortunately not high enough, and he's gonna get taken out. But if you're Mayhem, give up this inhibitor. It's dead. To keep yourself in this game, you have to defend at the core.
Right. I think we sometimes, just personally, when we play, we see a lot of teams. They put too much emphasis on that inhibitor. Like, well, we got to defend it, but like, yeah, if you die now, you're done. Like, they're just gonna push to the core. So Mayhem doing a smart thing here, but looks, Stratum Gora still wants to end it.
They're gonna go for it. They're trying to defend it. Core already down to half, but I mean, even Rampage at this stage of the game is gonna get value. The flame belch coming out from solo Nazgul doesn't even matter, ladies and gentlemen. Congratulations, SOA. They looked great. They looked strong. They had a little bit of a roster change with Omei no longer being on the team.
Yeah.
But if they can continue to play this way, I talked about it. Consistency is their biggest problem. If they can consistently play like that, we could see them in the finals, man. It all depends on them keeping cool-headed in a match. When they get behind, make sure they don't lose their composure. And I think we're seeing the formation of a beautiful team right here in Strait of Agora.
Yeah, so I played very, very well there. We did see some subs over on Team Mayhem, but what we saw was incredible gameplay out of SOA. I don't think it mattered if Mayhem had their roster. Triple melee and that jungle is so strong. So, and a lot of people are saying it's all about the Rangers right now.
Really not.
I've talked to guys from Triangle Formation. We watched Triangle Formation triple melee last week, very similar comp, decimate with it. It's a very strong comp right now. If you're able to effectively farm the jungle, not only your side, but aggressively invade the enemy jungle, while picking up those kills, the early game is so strong for these teams that they're able to, they're able to snowball the match out of control in their favor. Yeah. They got very aggressive for SOA, and that's what happened there. They were very aggressive, and it worked perfectly for them. So very good game for SOA.
One thing I also want to say about Mayhem, I kind of want to commend Griever specifically. I was watching him for most of the game. It seemed even when they were far behind, he was still in the enemy jungle, taking the enemy's jungle away from them, which I thought was very commendable. I mean, sometimes you look at that, you're like, well, they're in our jungle, what do we do? And Griever's like, I'm just going to go to their jungle. Like, it was a really interesting play to see. Obviously, you know, trying to make the best out of the situation he was in, trying to stay in it. So I guess the story is how do teams not come back from a snowball? How do you stop a snowball? I guess
it's entirely predicated upon your own play. You have to, if your team's invading your jungle, wards are so prevalent in this game. Defensively ward your jungle. Put a ward by your blue buff and your red buff, or maybe a little bit further forward, the entrance from the side lanes. Mid lane, it's pretty easy to scope out when you're getting invaded in the mid lane. But it's those side lanes are kind of very easy to get through unnoticed into the enemy team's jungle. Just put a ward around there. Ward smart. Yeah. I think that's the biggest thing about it. And also recognizing, hey, Grux has been missing for X amount of time. Steel's been missing for X amount of time.
Yeah.
You have to be very, very cognizant, and you have to respect a composition that has a Grux and a Rampage and a Steel. I mean, Rampage plus Grux on its own level, immediately when you see that sort of composition, that screams, we're going to be getting in your jungle, we're going to be getting aggressive. And if you don't respect it, that's what happens.
Do you think that every single member, all five, should have a ward or a warding item? Or is that just for a couple players? Not Shane.
I don't think all five should have it, depending on the type of ward you have. Two or three players can have it, and depending on how you build your heroes come late game. I definitely think like a jungler, if they have the ability to pick it up, they should pick it up pretty early, make sure they're counter warding. But for the most part, I like to see my laners pick it up early on.
Yeah.
You've got 3-point shadow wards you can purchase. I believe with some of the with the rangers, for example, you can pick up the shadow ward, and the names are escaping me right now. I apologize, but if you were to build that, like you would build another damage card,
Lord's Ward, Guardian Ward,
yeah,
Ward, Sorcerer's Ward.
Shane knows ward. All of them.
Okay, nailed Shane. It.
And you basically.
I'm pretty sure I just named every single ward in the game. Nailed it.
You can build them to add with damage. You can put physical damage or energy damage in them, and you're not losing out on too much. Whether that's the best way to do it, it's you want to have at least, I would say, 3 people. Long-winded answer, but I would say at least 2 to 3 people with a ward, so you're able to effectively ward and counter ward the jungle.
All right, well, we'll see as that, obviously, the jungle being a lot more important. The XP, the card power that it gives, trying to keep teams from snowballing. We'll see if the teams will ward more, counter ward. We'll see if that becomes in play next week. But that is all for tonight, ladies and gentlemen, here at the Paragon Masters. Great question, by the way. So the Agora, these are the top 6 teams right now, top 5 teams right now in Agora, or in Paragon Masters. They have qualified from the Agora's Rising tournaments that these beautiful men put on, which another one, the next one is the 23rd and the 24th. Yes, you guys. Yes, you guys.
Jesus, that's so nice.
Knock it off. I don't have any Cheez-Its right now, but I would eat them. And so they are now playing for a starting prize pool of $1,500 plus whatever you beautiful people are raising on Match Arena, which right now is $398. Thank you for donating tonight. You guys are awesome. You guys are amazing. And all of the money goes to those players. Awesome games all around tonight. Strat of Gora and Triangle Formation, congratulations for your 2 wins. Highlights for tonight, I guess for me, I don't know about you guys, but watching the Grimex Shockwave the steal to miss his ult was
so nice.
We're going to go back and watch that. I want to make just like a highlight hype video about that where he repeats that over and over with some John Cena music in there if we can get it. But for me, that was probably the highlight. How was you guys?
That for me was such a good moment. I mean, so poor Nebos. He thought he was hitting everybody.
I feel like I'm a failure as a play-by-play commentator because I didn't recognize what was going on. But I even said it, and I'm like, I like Nebos with the huge shockwave and completely misses his ultimate.
Nope,
like,
nothing.
I was
Nebos under the bus.
That just happened. Like,
just Nebos, sorry, you're Nebos. So bad. Nebos,
you're not. But, no one could have saw that coming. No one could have saw that coming.
Yeah. It was a great play out of Easy Peasy.
It was, man.
That for me was definitely the play of the night. Nebos, he tried. Shane threw you under the bus. Nebos, if you're here, I apologize for Shane. I don't know why he's being so rude to you. I think you're a good steal.
Yeah.
But that was definitely the play of the night for me.
All right, guys. Again, thank you so much for joining us here at the Paragon Masters. On behalf of everyone, make sure you guys tune in next Tuesday for our another matchup as Shane just shows off all of his awesome merch. We get it.
How do I get this to? It's not working.
Notch will walk you through it later. Notch, are you streaming after this?
I am not streaming after this. I've got an 8:00 dentist appointment.
Okay. Well, wow.
What?
Wow. What a dentist appointment.
You're joking, right?
No, it's 100%. 8:00 dental appointment.
What sort of dentist is it?
It's not for me. It's for my daughter. So I have to be dad, and I have to go hold her hand.
Dad of the year. Dad of the year, right there.
Yeah. So.
Thank you so much. Well, then we'll find someone.
Hey, I'll stream it.
All right. Well, I guess Shane is going to stream, and then we will host Shane. So stick around for that and tune in next Tuesday for some amazing matchups. But on behalf of everyone here at the Paragon Masters, that is Shane Lynch. This is another Notch. I am Toast Reloading, my friends, fans, and Gray Stoners, and we are going Paragon. Oh, no.
Sorry. I'm sorry. We did it again.
We did it again.
We're
not sorry. I'm not sorry. This water.
Let's get out of here.